In the beginning, the first theater was undoubtedly improvised.
Scene!
The Greeks introduced scripts, and the rest was history.
History? I get it!
A couple thousand years later, traveling groups of players in Italy performed Commedia dell'arte, a form of theater where the actors improvised within a loose plot framework called a scenario. Molière based a number of his plays on commedia plots and characters, and it was all scripts for the next 400 years. In the 1930s and 40s, a Works Project Administration drama supervisor named Viola Spolin began to solve her problems directing untrained children by developing theater games that used playfulness to unlock individual creativity. Today, we'd call these improvisation exercises. In 1948, her son, Paul Sills, enrolled at the University of Chicago. There, he began directing with the student-led theater group Tonight at 8:30, and with the Playwrights Theater Club. Together with David Shepard and a brave group of actors, they developed a form to serve their ideas about socially relevant theater. On July 5, 1955, seven young actors in Chicago's Hyde Park performed an improvised show and became the modern era's first improvisational theater company. The name of their ensemble?
The Compass.
Over the next 4 years, The Compass expanded to companies in three more cities: Boston, New York, and St. Louis. From The Compass was born the second city, the off-loop theater movement, and the use of storefront theaters now common to Chicago's theater landscape. In theater, the alumni of The Compass include dozens of illustrious names like Alan Alda, Alan Arkin, Jane Alexander, Ed Asner, Shelley Berman, Jack Burns,
Del Close,
Paul Dooley, Ted Flicker, Barbara Harris, Elaine May, Paul Mazursky, Ann Miera, Mike Nichols, David Shepard, Paul Sills, and Jerry Stiller. And the work The Compass began by bravely stepping on stage without a script 50 years ago has become a worldwide phenomenon.
David Shepard is the man who produced the first professional improvisation company in the United States, Compass. If it wasn't for David's work in improvisation, if it wasn't for his contributions to American theater, I don't think we would have had Saturday Night Live or Mad TV or Second City. In the early 50s, David felt that American theater was bloodless.
He's a kid from Exeter, a kid from Harvard. He's got a lot of theatrical experiences. He wants to transform the theater. He gets a little inheritance, and he says, I'm going to take this, and I'm going to change the world.
When I went to New York Cabaret, it was very swish. It was women in long gowns and men in tuxedos talking about the difficulties of their lives. And I said to myself, well, is this the culture of New York? I don't want to do a popular theater in New York.
Well, there was this whole crazy thing about where am I going to go? David says, where am I going to go? Am I going to go to New York? I'm going to go to Ohio, St. Louis. I'll hitchhike somewhere and I'll wind up in Chicago.
I was on my way to Cleveland with a truck driver who was taking me towards Indianapolis, and he said, don't go. He said, stay with me, because I'm going to crash on the road if you don't keep me awake telling me your stories. So I stayed with him, and that's how come I went to Chicago, and that's how come improvisational theater started in Chicago.
You're being guided to where you have to go. So David was guided to this whole political, social upheaval that was Chicago in the 50s.
on this campus, or just off it, where the atom bomb had been assembled, David Shepherd arrived with his dream to start a workers' theater. He did not know what he was getting into, and it kind of exploded, just like the bomb.
So he hitchhiked to Chicago, where through the University of Chicago, he first encountered the repertory group Tonight at 8:30.
I knew about Paul before I met him because he was a myth in the University of Chicago Society. And I made a date to have coffee with him, and he forgot about it totally. So I was left in the coffee shop looking at this leonine personality talking to his friends, and figured out eventually that that was Paul Sills.
He had great respect for Paul. You know, they were like unique twins. Not identical, fraternal.
David and Paul discovered they had a common interest in theater.
He was really bringing a lot of European avant-garde theater to the campus of the University of Chicago, but to the United States for the first time.
They were infatuated with German theater, which they produced in association with the university even before the university had a theater department.
One of the nice things about the university was it had no theater department. So we were able to do whatever we wanted. Paul Sills and David Shepherd were involved in the university theater. In fact, Paul directed a play written by David.
Paul was also directing at the University of Chicago, directing a workshop, which startled me and stunned me, really. It was so wonderfully rich and active without any script at all the time, creating a great deal of concrete reality through the games that Paul was using, which were the games of Viola Spolin.
In the beginning, 'twas Viola the Spolin, and she spaketh the words, go ye forth and improvise.
Viola was the mother of improvisational theater.
She was the intellectual and the logician behind the improvisational movement, because she had created games which were about to be published.
I don't know if she was ever a Reichian, a Wilhelm Reichian, but she certainly understood restriction and obstruction in the body, and she knew just at what point to release it. And if you look at these games, I think it's a compendium of, over 200 games? Every one of them attends to some little resistance point. And if you open up that fountain, you've got another piece of theater to work with.
And the deal they made was, if David would assist with the repertory company, Playwrights Theater Club, in turn, Paul would help David create his vision of a popular theater. So David made his resources available to Paul. He financed Playwrights Theater, where over a course of 2 years, they produced about 21 different plays.
David wanted more. David wanted this workers' theater where workers stood on top of tabletops at lunchtime and put on, you know, stuff about their real lives.
I put up with this role of producer for 2 years, and we produced all these plays, and eventually, when Playwrights folded, I said, well, now, folks, it's time to do cabaret theater in Hyde Park. And we did.
No miracle was ever as big as the miracle of the compass. I mean, that seems to have been, you know, if you talk about a zeitgeist or a perfect storm, that's where the compass emerged. That's how the compass emerged.
They decided that what was necessary to bridge the gap from tremendously commercial theater to tremendously amateur theater was something that people could co-create.
I called it Compass because I wanted to document, dramatize where we were coming from and where we were going to.
David and Paul Sills, may he rest in peace, were kind of instrumental in taking Viola Spolin's vision of improvisation for the theater, of a games format, and moving it into the next level, which was, how do we explore what's going on in our life now?
It was very intellectual theater with a very liberal idea, which attracted me. It was like, it was probably going to be like street theater. Who could do a rent strike better than people who are having a rent strike? You know, that had validity to me. And he wanted it to be a theater for the people. He wanted miners to come and farmers. And well, what he landed up with was every intellectual from University of Chicago who had any talent. And it became a very popular theater for middle-class intellectuals.
The University of Chicago at the time had sort of an open admissions policy where it was possible for someone who was even 15 years old to take a test and then be placed in the college. So these are very intelligent people, and they all clicked together.
I mean, these were people in the post-war period who came to the University of Chicago very young, you know, very hyper-educated, outcasts, misfits, but very, very high IQs. I mean, that really characterized the early Compass.
I soon realized that these were high IQ, terrific minds. The humor had in both the base that I was coming from, but a base that is no, it's not part of my background. And I watched them in awe.
Compass was a way of pointing at things. And what they were pointed at, usually sardonic, left-wing kind of material examining both the social mores of the time and what was happening politically with each other. They used the Compass as a means to show the excellence of their improvisers. When you have Mike Nichols, Elaine May, Shelley Berman, et cetera, who are your players, you got something exciting on stage.
I started as a producer in a state of mania because everything was going so well.
He was in the perfect place at the perfect time. This was a university campus replete with geniusy people, really smart, sophisticated people. And so when this really geniusy group of performers got on stage and satirized society that they were in, it was like the perfect audience for this perfect group of people.
David wanted to create something called scenario plays, which were about 500 words between 1 to 2 pages about politics, relationships.
We started looking for scenario plays. We got several, but they were of no interest. They lay flat on the table without any verve or spontaneity. And so Paul said to me, well, we can improvise these.
I don't know how much they influenced each other's work, to tell the truth. The fact that they were together didn't mean that they were influencing each other. They went off in such different directions.
David never had a brother. He never had a sister. I think Paul was like a brother for him. And he loved Paul very much. I don't know how Paul felt about David, but they were very loyal to each other.
And I'm not sure that what the relationship was something to push against for each of them.
They use Viola's methods to train the Compass players on how to bring these scenario plays to life.
That's what Paul brought into our work when we started Playwrights Theater Club, and that's what he tried to continue when we went into the spear stage of the Compass.
It was a laundry, as I remember, and next to it was a bar, but it had a wall, and we had to cut a hole in that. They took leases on both places. And then Sills and I did most of the construction. We built the stage, and then the louvers, and then we did the wall getting into the bar, soundproofing, and so on.
The way Compass was designed it would open with a format called The Living Newspaper.
We used to get the cast together on, like, I think about Thursday with crayons and scissors and glue, and a stack of six of the periodicals we're going to dramatize, and we'd sit around and we'd say, well, Barbara, you do the monologue on page four. Michael, you come in with the explanation of the caption, and we'll stand up and we'll do the picture. It was usually about 10 or 15 minutes long, and it opened the show with a bang.
When you're in the middle of it, you're not thinking of your historical reference or achievement or whatever. It's we sure had a hell of a lot of fun. It was a great time, as I say. For me, it would be heaven, because you just didn't meet that kind of atmosphere when you were in the theater or in films. There was too much restrictions on the actor. You felt you were soaring, your spirit. You could go out there and fail to a point. I mean, obviously, with Sills around, he'd let you know if you were, you know.
Well, neither one of them, when it came to directing, was what I would call articulate. But they both had a passion. And they had a passion that, in their own individual ways, was very decent and unusual.
A lot of people were amazed, thought that the work was scripted, and didn't believe us when we told them it was not.
And I never had such a good audience, just marvelous. But it was pretty much an intellectual audience.
Our audience was diversified. I must have been Catholic. But we never heard from anybody in the audience that, how dare you do this or that, you know.
The suggestions, who's got an idea? I'll play whatever you want me to play. Who's got an idea? That's where I was. They were watching us solve an immediate problem that they had presented to us. And whether we did it successfully or not, it did not matter. That struggle to do it was as alive as any jazz band could ever be. And that's what we did.
What followed next was the scenario play.
A scenario play is an outline for a play. And it probably was used by Commedia dell'arte. David had a very distinct idea of what each scenario should accomplish.
A lot of improvisation seems to have to do with types. The hippie, the businessman. In a scenario, what you get is a process of kind of crawling through the culture. You see in detail how families are composed, how businesses are composed. It comes to an end in its own way, very often changing from performance to performance. The whole show might have been 90 minutes, but I mean, the scenario, which was the core of the show, was only about 30 or 40 minutes long, and it was usually written by Elaine May. She was carrying around scripts underneath her arm for months at a time.
And so many of those early scenario plays that he helped contribute to and Elaine May contributed to, they were very serious gambits at how to construct an examination of family relationships.
These scenario plays had titles like How to Catch a Tax Evader, The Game of Hurt.
And Roger Bowen wrote a few. Roger wrote the first one that we did even before we opened Compass. It was called Enterprise. One guy who saw it gave us an enormous gift to start Compass, and that's what paid for our lease.
And the themes that were being explored were first dates, getting a job.
In addition, he was interested in politics, but I think really that he wanted to see, the class differences.
They had their finger on the pulse of what people were like, and they didn't go much for yuck-yuck-ha-ha. The comedy came out of the situations. Comedy came out of the characters.
When we started Compass, had nothing to do with comedy, it had to do with satire.
He wants things real. He doesn't care about laughter or comedy or jokes.
He wanted the emotion to be sincere.
A lot of the times, especially on Friday and Saturday nights when we did two or three shows, we would lose track of this reality and Paul would bellow at us, insist on us getting it back.
He was there briefly. He was there in the early workshops, but he was, as you know, he was going off to Bristol, I think it was England, to do a Fulbright. So I just knew Paul briefly, enough to know that there was trouble here, you know what I mean? It was not uncommon for him to throw up his hands and walk out the door, and that was it. You weren't going to see him anymore, so we kind of look around and, well, it's, you know, show must go on. So we went back to workshops again. And then he would wander back in about maybe 2 days, 3 days later, and David would be there, of course, all through this. But David always seemed to be a specter. I worked with him on stage, great presence, and he had a kind of charm, and, you know, he could come out and talk to the audience. But always he seemed somewhat professorial, the academic, you know what I mean? And he didn't have that relaxed kind of thing. But never a problem the way Sills was. Sills was a pressure, a tension, you know, because he could explode.
Our original intention, which was to show the audience what they were reading, changed into amuse the audience.
The comment was becoming more important. The intellectual comment was becoming more important than the behavior.
He was quite disappointed in how it turned out. The more successful it became, the more disillusioned David became.
David and the people involved with Compass eventually burnt out. They were doing a new show every single week. So they were rehearsing during the daytime and performing shows at night.
You know, Broadway, you rehearse and rehearse and rehearse, and then you do, and you run for a year or two. The pressure was on. I mean, it was almost like, you know, sink or swim.
That was the pace at which we thought we should go. When I tell other people who are in Second City, for instance, that with our pace, they're just amazed, they're horrified. I started to give my place on the stage up to people who were much more talented than I was. I started to stay at home and try to figure out what a producer was.
And David put his own money into it. I remember him telling me over and over again that it just wouldn't have happened if I was not willing to put my own money into it.
And I eventually became quite depressed. That's where I more or less lost control of Compass.
He lost control early. And when Sills left and went to Bristol, David was sort of in charge, and he couldn't control that group. I don't know if it was lack of respect or just he didn't have that kind of authority that you know, which sometimes makes someone unpleasant. Sills was certainly unpleasant.
Compass became extraordinarily popular, and what happened was Compass became more about producing stars.
Well, that's not what David wanted. He was quite disappointed in how it turned out.
Some of these real actors dropped out and the improvisers came in, you know, people that David wanted. David wasn't so keen for real actors. He didn't really want them. He didn't want professional actors. And so the Compass was a kind of mixture of both. And I think Sills always was leaned toward the real actors, Sir Shepard always towards the amateur.
Well, I think he felt he could mold them in a way that professional actors had gone beyond the possibility of being molded. He placed a great value on the spontaneity of the expression.
Because I was not a canny producer, I didn't keep increasing the price, although I could have, as the show became more and more successful. And I could have increased the salaries of the players gradually. So they would all feel that they were in this business together. When the people in the company struck for higher wages, they wanted $55 a week instead of $25, I went along with that. Instead of closing the company down saying we can't afford it, I went along with it because I wanted to keep Compass going. And I eventually went $10,000 into debt.
There's a tradition in improvisation. You want to do it, you're going to pay for it. You know, you're not going to get paid to improvise. You're going to have to pay to do it. You're going to have to rent this and print that and call those and put those lights there and that music there. And it's going to cost you X amount of dollars. Only a handful of people ever really make money out of improvisation.
Elaine May, Mike Nichols, Barbara Harris, Shelley Berman, they were capable of doing a show anywhere in the world, never mind Hyde Park. And they were able to do a show in any medium, radio, TV, you name it. They were able to do it, and they were able to make a living, which I couldn't do for them. I felt they owed us something, but they didn't. I think that if I had set up a better licensing agreement with them at the beginning, they would have maybe contributed something at the end. But that was another mistake that was made.
I think it evaporated from David. It's as if it evaporated.
I think that he didn't really follow through on his own notion, which might have been to build a theater or to go back to what was smaller and more intimate and more functional for amateurs, you know? I think that it died of its own lack of direction, or his own lack of direction. He didn't know what to do with it. He knew how to get it going, but he didn't know how to make it, how to mobilize the energy to a big hit. She didn't want anyway, so he was stuck.
And David, who was burnt out at that time, felt it was time to move on.
He didn't have control. I don't think he knew how to be the villain, the boss, you know? And which is to his advantage, I mean, as a human being, but it didn't help running that group.
Although he did go on to create other Compass companies in various other cities, like St. Louis, Philadelphia, New York, and Washington.
David was a visionary. He had a concept of the theater that he had in his mind and that he wanted to see, and he had a certain number of pretty strong techniques for how to evoke this theater. He also had a great sense of who was talented. He hired so many wonderful actors for his subsequent Compass companies, you know, the Compass at the upstairs, at the downstairs, or Hyannisport. All these Compasses were filled with brilliant people.
Our company in Hyannisport was made up of people with totally different backgrounds, like Diana Sand was in the company, Ron Wayan, Renee Santoni, and my first wife, Honey Shepherd.
When I was at Bennington, all these rich girls would leave for the weekend to go to Chicago to meet David Shepherd. Well, when I graduated, I studied with Larry in New York, and one night, David Shepherd was in the audience. It was a class. I didn't know who it was. But after the class, he said to Larry, I'd like to meet that girl. And that was me. So then I moved to New York a week later to McDougal Street. And on the day that I moved, it was a Saturday, David Shepherd and Larry Arick and I went to see a movie. And then we went to a party. And then David came home with me, and he never left. And we were married 4 months later.
And they simply didn't have the same cohesion and imagination that I was used to working with in Chicago. But in fact, what works is a community in which there's an important university and literally thousands of people around it who have been trained at that university and who are sophisticated. Hyannisport is not that type of place. Neither is St. Louis, although we were successful in St. Louis with a very different company, including Alan Arkin and Jerry Stiller and his wife, Nancy Ponder. We played there, I think, two or three different times. But I didn't have the facility to write satirical scenes that would work wherever I went. So that's a big revelation to me about what happened.
It was very, very painful for me to watch, but I think David lost control of it. It became very difficult for him to lead it.
That group that went down to St. Louis was certainly a group that I don't think David knew what hit him, you know what I mean, or how to be the boss, if you want to say that, if you mean by control, that making the decisions. Because by that time, what he imagined Compass to be was was not there.
And the last performance, I tore up my equity card and I said, that's it, no more for me. Because I didn't enjoy it. I love it now. I have come up with wonderful improvisations for my actor students I teach. And a great understanding has come from it. But I didn't enjoy doing it at the time.
Compass was the moment in time coming out of the soup of the Midwest, out of their social consciousness, their political needs. It was a moment in time not repeatable.
And we have almost no surviving video or film. So the whole Compass experience is in the dark.
That must be a signal that there was something really great happening, is the lack of forgetfulness on the part of anyone who was there. The vivid, vivid memories of what worked, what was good, how this one, you know, got this laugh or that laugh, or moved their foot this way or made that face. Really, you envy them for being there.
Compass evolved into Second City in 1959.
What happened was, about 3 years after Compass collapsed, Paul Sills and Howie Hawke and Bernie Sahlins came to my apartment in New York, where I had now a wife and two children, and asked me to come to Chicago to work with them on something they called Second City. Well, we were all out of work. I had sold my business for enough to be poor on, and Paul was out of work, and Barbara Harris, and that whole first company. And what we were going to do was build a coffee shop, because that's what one did in the 60s. And then we said, why not put a little show in there? And I thought about it for a while, and then I said no, because I wanted to stay with my family.
It's very hard to make a living as a producer of Improv Cabaret and support a wife and two kids.
You know, looking back on my life, I realized that was a big mistake. Should have gone for 6 months or whatever I could do. You know, I would have assured me of an income, so I wouldn't have to take jobs as I did.
It wasn't the real thing, the Second City, but it was the thing that he was so depressed about the collapse of the Compass in Chicago, I think, that, you know, doing a version of it or doing an imitation of it, even more spiffed up and more commercial, he just wasn't interested.
So in a way, David, he missed. But I think he would have been in trouble at Second City, because the whole tone was different.
Well, yeah, he felt that Second City had abandoned the improvisational format in order to gain commercial success. Use improv to create sketches, scenarios, and jokes, but very little real improv going on to this very day.
The only improvisation we would use as a presentational form would be a game, perhaps, in a whole show.
Well, Second City is not interested in scenarios. They are very much interested in humor. Satire is very sharp.
David had a streak of mysticism in him that applied to his work. He assumed that spontaneity trumped everything else. He assumed that improvisation trumped content.
If you go to Second City, you will see their show, which may have been developed out of improv, using some improv, but it's a scripted show, and it's wonderful. Funny, always.
The directors are required to produce something that's very finished, polished.
But the improvisation that they reserve at the end of things, they give themselves planning time. They're the purists amongst us who say planning time is not improvisation. Second City is primarily focused on getting laughter. Nothing wrong with laughter in a sad and sick world. But David would say they're not really improvising.
The audience was right there. At Compass, it always seemed to be they were way off, so he had physically room to do all this. Whereas in Second City, it was cabaret, and the audience had evening gowns and taxis, limousines pulling up, and you know, it was a totally different atmosphere. That's not David's atmosphere.
And then when it took off, Well, anybody feels like this, I think. You make a stupid business decision in your life. You say, nah. Or a love decision, even. I don't want to see that person again. And then the next thing you know, that person has, you know, invented YouTube.
Compass was a dump, a barn. And as I said, we took our clothes off. I did a lot of scenes with my shirt off and hair, you know, the thing, no makeup and thing. Second City was suits. We had three-piece suits at one point.
I don't really know if David would have fit in.
But they go on. They're going into their 50th anniversary, I think, now.
David was missed the train, missed the boat. He was left out, and it depressed him.
There's a certain permanent sense of loss there, and he couldn't catch up with it because he basically didn't want to. I think when he's 90, he may realize he was doing exactly what he wanted to do.
I think Shepard would have been at a loss there. I mean, it's too bad that, but I don't think he would have stayed very long. I mean, Sills didn't. Sills kept wanting to leave.
Would he have fit in at Second City? I don't think so. I think his love of improvisation was greater than his love of laughter. Second City had a different mandate. I don't think it would have worked.
Towards the end of the 60s, David's marriage abruptly broke up. And he decided to go back into improvisation.
Community Makers were set up to correct ailing communities. Well, I put an ad out in a paper, and he showed up.
Howard Jerome Gomberg.
I saw an ad in the newspaper, I forget which paper it was, the Post, that said, Community Makers. We're looking for people to do community making. I said, me? That's like, community is one letter short of being commune. Commune? I could do that.
I'm basically straight. I come from a very straight family, very straight society, and Howard is very different from me.
I was, as David says, he's a university kind of guy, kind of a straight guy, but I come out of a different story. I was involved with left-wing politics in New York. I was the troubadour for the Socialist Labor Party.
He comes from a turbulent Jewish family, and he has worked as a wrestler, a football player. He's done tab musicals, and he comes from a very different society from what I come from, and so we came together and we mixed.
The idea of using improvisation as a people's theater really appealed to me for my red flag waving sense that we can create our own theater. We don't have to wait, to save up our pennies and go see Broadway, that we can do our own shows together. And it might be an opportunity to explore the situations in the world and shed some light on them, albeit from a totally left-wing perspective, which is where I was coming from.
He just fitted in beautifully and came with a lot of ideas. Brought a lot of friends.
I met David and we began discussing what a people's theater might look like, how we can build a community using improvisation. His language is different from mine. He's an upper class college educated guy, and I'm a Brooklyn guy from the streets. So we had to find a way to meet linguistically, because his interests were, and his background was vastly different than my own. We found a common language through improvisation.
In 1972, Community Makers became Group Creativity Projects, an organization that enables amateurs to develop their own plays, novels, poetry, movies through improvisation.
And we had a whole variety of forms to explore. How do you build a community? How do you make a community out of improvisation? And what is our obligation to the greater community? How can we act as spokespersons in issues that people may be afraid to talk about or don't have a creative way to talk about? So for me, it was a big soapbox at the time.
Eventually, we ended up in the Times Square area at a building that encouraged new formats to come and rent space. It's called the Space for Innovative Development. That's where we spent several years.
What we did there was fantastic, was we work with at-risk youths. We get a groups of kids from a drug therapeutic program, and we would use improvisational formats for them to look at alternatives to their life. In fact, David and I developed something that we called Option City. Option City, that you had other options to situations in your life. And it was one incredible story, but the one I can relate now. There was a young boy of Spanish Puerto Rican descent who was in big trouble. Drugs, petty crime, etc. is heading nowhere. He was on a prison release program. He comes to us as part of the therapy that they're supposed to receive. And we put him through a series of improvisations, which had to do with sending him out to get a job. He has a girlfriend. He'd like to do something with the girlfriend. He has a mother. He'd like to get his mother a nice house, but he can't get a job because he's been in trouble. And so every improvisation we gave him, we set him up with a job, and then we'd bring him back. We'd jump forward in time. How did it go? And he'd tell his girlfriend, oh, I didn't get the job again. The man disrespected me. The man did this and the man did that. And then we sent it to another job interview. Did you get the job? No, he looked at my thing and he said this, that, and I know. So we gave him three or four scenarios to play in. Each time he found, creatively enough, a way to avoid getting the job. And finally we gave him the job. In the next scenario, we just gave him the job. You got the job. Now jump ahead 5 years. Well, his whole life opened up. He became a new person. He married his girlfriend. He got his mother a house outside of the city. He became respectable, had a goal in his life, something he couldn't even imagine, even in play, in improvisation. We forced it on him, and a whole part of his brain opened up to give him potential for a new life. That was very exciting to see the, in that case, the sociotherapeutic use of improvisation in a dramatic or comedic setting. It was amazing.
They formed the responsive scene, which was first developed as a stage show where the audience was involved giving story suggestions and directing.
The idea behind responsive scene was to become responsive to the show that was being developed by the actors by asking them to go into the future, to express more emotion, to sharpen their characters.
We've developed many, many different formats to look at how people create together. And remember one of them called 4D TV? The fourth dimension was the audience. And we would allow them on stage, we would allow them to redirect, we'd allow them, et cetera, et cetera. The only thing we didn't allow them to do is hit us. We learned that the hard way. Never allow the audience to hit you. It's not a good idea.
Around that time, 1972, Howard developed a relationship with Bob Lifton, who was a producer at WRVR-FM in New York City.
They had this hour available, so we took it, and we developed a format that would work on radio.
David pitched the responsive scene in one sentence: listening audience creates their own radio show.
The responsive scene enabled the audience to call in with suggestions on the phone, give us characters, scenes to play. I would answer the phone. This is RVR, Riverside Radio, responsive scene. What do you want to play?
It's a scene about a landlord and a hippie. It's about eviction. Go.
And we'd improvise that.
The way we promoted the show was through an announcement we made about a half an hour before it went on the air, saying, we're looking for suggestions, call them into this number. And sure enough, people called.
One of the amazing things about doing that show, in the 6-8 months, I think we had only one person who said something really off the wall, off the collar, bad. Otherwise, people in New York City just wanted to play this new creative thing called the responsive scene, and they were into it.
Well, I only remember about five people sitting around a big table willing to play themselves or play characters in whatever scene was suggested by the audience.
So this kid, Michal Golden, calls in, and he soon becomes a regular. In fact, we couldn't stop him, and he just wanted to play. And I remember he would call in with great suggestions for great scenes. One of them was this crazy story about pizza being delivered at the wrong place, and wonderful.
This is your radio show, the radio show you can help to create by calling 595-8900. We allow you, we need you to tell us what kind of show this should be, what kind of stories, scenes, plays you want this show to have. And we have professional actors sitting around the table. With me tonight are...
Sheldon Biber.
Lynn Burnfield.
Linda Stein.
Bob Aberdeen.
Penny Kurtz.
And I am Jerome. And we are waiting for you to tell us what kind of scenes you want to hear over the radio. The responsive scene, your radio theater of the air.
We have a lot of calls on the line. And we have a fellow by the name of Michael on the phone who has got a scene with his about his wife ordering a pizza pie. Why don't we let Michael explain the scene? Good evening, Michael.
Good evening.
Hi, Michael.
Hi. What do you got for us, Mike?
Well, I got a scene here.
Yeah?
This is about a woman who's alone in her house. Her husband's at work, and she's on a strict diet, and she's dying for something to eat. Now, the doorbell rings, and when she answers it, it turns out to be a delivery boy with a pizza at the wrong address.
Okay.
Okay.
You want to be the delivery boy?
Yeah.
Fantastic.
I'm brave.
Right.
Brave tonight.
Oh, the door. Oh, that's a good... Hello?
Hi, I got a pizza here for you.
You're kidding. You have a pizza for me?
Yeah. Didn't you,
Did my husband send you? This is a test, I know it. My husband sent you, didn't he?
A lady, I don't know what you're talking about.
No, it's okay. My husband sent you, and that means it's okay for me to eat it. Come on in.
Lady, please, control yourself.
Why wouldn't I control myself? It's a present from my husband, because he knows I've been so good lately.
Lady, it's a pizza, believe me.
I'll take it. It's a pizza. I know it, and I'll take it.
It's $1.75, lady.
Oh, no, I'm sure if my husband sent it, he paid for it.
You're not going to get away with this.
You're going to charge me twice. I know my husband paid
for it.
Give me
that pizza.
Give me that pizza.
Yes.
It's my pizza.
Lady.
Give it to me.
Lady,
Michael Golding was a kid, and he wanted to play, and he thought we were grown-up playmates. And to this very day, we are close friends brought together by the magic of improv.
A lot of people thought that they should develop very unreal scenarios for us to play out, and the people sitting at the desk who thought that they could play unreal characters and exaggerate the situations that came up. But we asked them to be real, which means to be emotionally real, I think.
He said it's not about comedic genius. It's about what are you interested in and what slant can you take to explore that thing. And forget about the joke, forget about the laughter, forget about the ha-ha. It will come if you're real. And we had to just trust that.
Sometimes we get two people calling in one after another. First, the husband calling in to complain about his wife's telling him that he had been unfaithful to her, and then the wife calling in and expressing the opposite point of view. We liked playing that very much, and this show went on for 6 months, but we never got commercial support.
When I talk about the old days of doing radio improv to people here, they say, well, that's a great idea. Why aren't we doing that now? Why don't we do that here? Well, CBC would love that. Let's write a performance. So could it happen again? Absolutely. Who's going to do it? It's probably not going to be me. Some young improviser is going to say, yeah, an improvised radio show where the call is calling. Yeah, that should happen, could happen, and you should do it.
When the responsive scene ended, this led into the creation of the Improv Olympics.
I don't consider the different formats that I developed to be important except for the Improv Olympics.
He was at his in-law's house one Thanksgiving, and he was appalled that after they consumed the turkey, they sat down on the couch and watched football.
I remember asking myself, why don't they look at a sport that involves them and their lives and their identities and their feelings, and the reason they're not doing that is because it hasn't been invented, but we can invent it. The Improv Olympics is a way of taking the energy of people onto the stage in the form of a team, or should I say, two teams who compete, so theater becomes a sport dominated by the ideas of the audience who say they want to see this or that in an event. To this day, it hasn't changed Thanksgiving a bit.
But I recall we were up at the Space for Innovative Development
And for some crazy reason, I said, let's choose upsides. Let's choose upsides. You know the way you do playing street anything, hockey, basketball, whatever it is. And we chose upsides. Okay, I got the guy in yellow, and I'll take the girl in the black thing there. What do you want? I'll take that fat guy. I want the skinny kid. So we chose upsides. And from that, it kind of evolved that this is a game. This thing called improvisation, this thing called group creativity, is also a game that could be played by teams. And from there, things kind of accelerated.
And that's how David and Howard came up with the Improv Olympics, which was really, at the time, a continuation of the Responsive Scene radio show.
A couple years after David started his Improv Olympics, Keith Johnstone out on the West Coast was creating Theater Sports.
During that period of time, within a year or so, on the planet Earth, like four different formats of competitive improvisation happened. And they all say they didn't know each other.
So it was in the air already, what he was doing. But nevertheless, he had some unique way to present improvisational theater.
This is what we put up, and this is what began to work. And we got more and more people interested in coming in and playing as teams.
It became obvious that we could form teams, and teams could, well, they could have some common interests together. It could be a team of teenagers, or as David later said, let's put together a team of rabbis versus a team of firemen, people who had affinities to something, and see what they could bring forward.
This was a sport now. This worked.
When David first premiered the Improv Olympics in 1972 at the Space for Innovative Development, I participated with the first teenage team, Fool's Paradise.
Michal Golding, 14-year-old kid, playing with us on the radio. Then we finally get to meet each other in person at his school. We develop the games, and now we can't get rid of him. He's everywhere.
And we got 11 high schools to pick up on the Improv Olympics and play year after year.
In essence, the Improv Olympics was really a loving celebration of the work of Viola Spolin, because that's how we would rehearse for the Improv Olympics, doing the games over and over and over again.
We expected her to renounce the whole project, but she didn't. She supported it. She said, this is good, provided you don't let the competition overwhelm it. So she saw that it had both good and bad features, and she was willing to put up with it.
There were four quarters in the original Improv Olympics where the audience would come in and fill out scene cards, and they would put those cards up on a corkboard, and the teams would choose which scenes they would do. The first two rounds, the actors played each other with the scenes from the cards. The audience watching had the opportunity to direct.
My attitude to theater is that the audience should be involved, not only as ticket buyers and spectators and people who bought sodas at intermission, but also as people who suggested scenes and came on stage and played them.
Very early on, we began training the audience not to make it difficult, but to make it easy. And in fact, one of the big breakthroughs was somebody wanted us to do something grotesque on stage. And we said, no, you do it. If you think that's going to be good and funny, you do it. I'll sit where you're sitting. You come up on stage and you do that. And pretty soon we began training the audience that this is not about putting the actors through hell. This is really about what are we interested in and how can we find out about that.
In the second half of the show, we got members from the audience to come on and play with the teams. David's vision of teams was always, show me your identity. Show me your identity through the scenarios you do, the themes you explore, the characters you show us. Tell us who you are.
But the important thing was teams came together, played these games with one another, meeting each other sometimes for the first time, and going through these processes together and getting very excited about the potential of it.
These matches were videotaped, so that at the end of the match, we could play it back.
I knew your grandfather, you camera, you. It's called the Sony Rover Portapack, and it weighed a lot more than you do, let me tell you.
And it was very exciting at the time, as Howard Jerome said, "Hey, Ma, look, we're on TV. We're breaking the rules."
My God, we create our own news, our own shows. The revolution is on.
When you videotape something, there's no point in keeping it unless you show it back to people who see it. After we videotaped it, it seemed almost necessary to play it back.
Well, I didn't try to smoke as much as I usually did, Your Honor.
Do you know what happened to you for being in the possession of drugs?
But was it my fault, Your Honor? Really, it wasn't. I swear it wasn't. It wasn't my fault.
Listen to the boy. He's young. He's very influential. Your Honor, have mercy.
Okay, let's see the father and the son preparing to go on their way out. I mean, on the way in the hallway, what really is going on between them.
Jesus Christ, I told you to get your goddamn haircut. Don't now you're gonna get convicted.
Tell me what to do.
You're gonna get convicted.
Don't
I know, but your mother's had it right up to here with you. I'm sick
mom.
And tired.
You've been probably giving Mom a hard time yourself, too, so don't bother me.
What is this, your third charge now?
In 1974, Howard and David were invited up to Toronto for the Homemade Theater Improv Festival. And this is where another layer was added to the Improv Olympics.
When Homemade Theater took it, they said, let's really make this a sport.
Well, what happened was a group of professionals got together and they tore apart our format and tried to make it more convincing, more Olympic, in fact.
Once we introduced the idea that there are teams, you have to have some criteria by which to judge things, because otherwise it's the difference between play and game. Play, you just play, and it's great. But game, then you need to have agreement on rules.
We just sat there and sounded as they did it. It took them about 2 hours to hand us back a very different format that works better.
So suddenly, there were referees, there were bells, there were scorecards.
We went from an elaborate Olympic metaphor to something much more functional.
We created actual events in the Improv Olympics. Each event was supposed to highlight a specific improv skill. A lot of these events sprang out of the direction. When we would have a direction change location, well, that became Space Jump. More emotion, be real, became the emotional hurdles. Take the scene ahead in time, back in time, that became Time Dash. Switch characters became Character Relay. Later on that year, Howard took the format to Ottawa to introduce it to a high school. And as improv folklore goes, Willie Wyllie, one of the founders of the Canadian Improv Games, was at that particular high school, but he wasn't allowed to participate.
I asked if I could go to the workshop, but because I was in grade 13 and there was no grade 13 drama, I was told no, which isn't a word that I accepted in those days.
And that's when Willie and his band of renegades invaded our improv games.
So all they knew about the format was it was called the Improv Olympics.
So my best friend Jack, who was in theater, and a lady named Gail decided we were getting in no matter what. So we dressed up as Olympians with Olympic torch and javelins.
They came in dressed like these crazy quasi-Olympiads with sheets on over their bodies and carrying cardboard flames.
And Howard burst onto the ground. Like literally, this man fell on the ground laughing and decided he gave us the permission that we were looking for to stay. And the rest is history.
What a strange choice for improvisation, Willie, because he is a lawyer today. But he had a strange and wondrous sense of humor and an ability to convince his pals to come along and play.
And that's where Willie Wyllie got interested and formed a team that would visit us in New York and play in the International Olympics, which was simply Canada and the United States.
David's original intention for the Improv Olympics is that he wanted it to be international. In fact, he wanted there to be Improv Olympic teams from all over the world.
We actually went to the Los Angeles Olympics. I remember we were performing on the Santa Monica Pier as a demonstration sport, sandwiched between the Frisbee Olympics and the Skateboard Olympics, and was then the Improv Olympics. And it was shortly after that that the Olympic Committee heard that we were doing something called the Improv Olympics, and they said, no, 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 no. No, no, no. Everything about Olympics is ours, and unless you want to have your creativity crushed by the Olympic Committee, you back off using that name. And so we had to change it from Olympics to Olympics, P-I-X. But even that was a little tough for the powers that be. They didn't want us to trade in on their name. And then we traded to the Improv Games, and that was a little less onerous from their point of view.
Howard insisted that we invite this fellow David Shepherd up, who had co-created the concept with him. And I said, sure, I didn't know, again, who David was or anything about him, but sure, if he has to be here, please come. He came and he brought this pimply young 17-year-old Jewish-Italian boy from Montreal named Michal Golding, who I later learned was his sort of protege. And that's how I met Michal, and we've been friends to this day.
Well, when I think about Michal from New York and Willie from Ottawa, two unlikely kids getting together around the same age with the same kind of love for the same thing, improvisation. And when they met, they just kept saying yes to each other. Yes, me too. Yes, me too. Yes, me too. And that continues to this very day. Yes, me too. Michal and Willie. Good for them.
We found a kinship with working with teenagers. There is something very extraordinary about seeing someone improvise for the first time and discovering with their fellow players they are not alone.
For the kids who had been labeled stupid and losers, when their friends, their teachers, and most of all their parents saw them do the most incredible things on stage because it was set up that they would not fail, all of a sudden their confidence was boosted, their parents looked at them in a different way, and it was not unusual for us to, hear of grades going up.
Let's just go out there and see what they're doing, right? Harry, just be cool. Now let's go out there, okay? All right. Quiet, please.
You should come in.
There's plenty of room,
They don't know it's us.
All right.
Can you see what they're doing? Look over my shoulder there. Come on, can you see what they're doing?
Yeah, they're looking at us. Because these games focus young people's attention and do it without costing much money, it's very popular. For most of these high school kids, the improvisation games are one of the highest experiences of their entire life. Yes, they'll get married. Yes, they'll have children. Yes, they'll get a job or they'll go to college, whatever it is. But yes, they've been improvisers and they have that memory.
In the late 70s and the early 80s, David began to experiment with a variety of different formats, a lot of them utilizing the events from the Improv Olympics.
David was looking at the great stories throughout history and seeing whether or not there was an improvisational format that would accommodate the telling of those stories in modern dress and modern day. So to look at Jonah being swallowed, what would Jonah be swallowed by today? What is the symbol of the whale today? But a corporation would swallow you up, or a relationship might swallow you up.
And out of that came Faust in the 21st century, the Jonah complex, and Donna Wanna. He went to Chicago in 1981 to continue fleshing out the Jonah complex.
Because of his relationship first to Compass and then to Second City, Chicago, he brought the games to Chicago. That's where Charna Halpern was.
I was driving home on the highway, and I had just heard on the way after my class that David Shepherd was in town auditioning for a play called The Jonah Complex. And then it hit me in the car. He had this thing in Canada called Improv Olympic, where different groups compete. Being one of those frustrated improvisers who was not on the main stage at Second City, I thought, well, you know, this could be a great thing. I can run that Improv Olympic thing here. We have enough troops to make that run. Because at that time, if you were not one of those six people on Second City, you weren't playing. So I got on the Cloverleaf and went right back downtown to I believe it was the Organic Theater, where David was auditioning people for the Jonah Complex. And I went right up to him, and he was very busy. He was swarmed with people with his little clipboard. And I said, I want to run Improv Olympic for you. I read about you at Something Wonderful right away, and I would like to do that. And he said, okay, in his very serious way. And then he said, but right now I'm auditioning for the Jonah Complex. Why don't you audition, and you can work with me on this too, and we can also talk about Improv Olympic. I ended up doing tech, being God, and helping him co-produce it, and then also doing Improv Olympics.
Yeah, well, we had two leagues, a professional league and a community league.
We even got identity teams, like a team of rabbis called the God Squad, and a team of psychologists called Freudian Slippers, and lawyers called Court Jesters, because David's idea was all these different communities to share their ideas. It was very successful.
For the professionals, it was just another gig. As wonderful as it was just another gig. But for the amateurs, no, it's life's calling.
We put them in a basement or an attic someplace or other with a couple of six-packs and just go through the events one after another. We developed a big reputation outside of Chicago and New York. People were saying, well, you got to go to Chicago because they have this new thing called the Improv Olympics. And I think that people did drift to Chicago to become involved. We had at one point, I think, 24 teams playing in Chicago. And that became a big deal every year. Played at the Second City on Monday nights. But didn't make any money for the producer, Charna Halpern.
David decided to go back to New York because it was still too small here to support both of us. And I was working full-time, and it was kind of paying my bills. And so he went to New York to open an Improv Olympic there. And that's not too far off from when the downfall started between us.
The two of them had a difference of opinion with where this should go. Charna was leaning more towards the Second City comedy satire area, but David was still more towards exploring what people were about. So they went their separate ways.
We just decided to stay separate. Our visions kind of changed, and we just decided to separate. He could have New York, and I would have Chicago.
Eventually, she just caved in and went for a comedy format at Improv Olympics near Wrigley Field.
I remained Improv Olympic for a very long time until I started getting called from the Olympic Committee. I met Del Close not too long after I left working with David. When we started doing long form, the name didn't fit. So when the Olympic Committee came for me to finally, you know, throw down the gauntlet and say, you got to change your name, I decided to make it IO. And that's the name that's carried on ever since.
And she has also a branch in Los Angeles, which is doing very well. She's making money.
Did all start long ago with David Shepherd, and I have to give David a lot of credit. Because a lot of those things were the ideas for what we're doing now. And I certainly would not be here if it wasn't for David. Neither would Improv Olympic or IO.
Interesting to note that this whole format was swept up from Chicago and taken to Canada.
After coming back from the prototype of the Improv Olympics at Homemade Theater, I decided that I'd really like to give this back to, you know, what I had shared to the next generation of kids behind me.
We're now 30-something years into the improv games here in Canada. 30-something years.
Start off by having everyone stand, please, and recite the Olympic pledge, please. Repeat after me. We have come together.
We have come together.
In the spirit of loving competition.
In the spirit of loving competition.
To celebrate the Canadian High School Improv Games.
To celebrate the Canadian High School Improv Games.
To uphold the ideals of improvisation.
To uphold the ideals.
To cooperate with one another.
To cooperate with one another.
To learn from each other.
And above all, to have a good time. I got involved with the improv games around 1992, so that would have been about 15 years, roughly, into its history.
We ran the Olympics back then as best we could with the kinds of rules we had then, the kinds of explorations we were doing.
What it started in the beginning was a small high school tournament with a few different schools.
And it caught fire in Ottawa, just caught fire. You couldn't put it out now. If you tried, it's just there.
Now we have, you know, 300 teams across Canada. We have 14 regional tournaments. There's now offshoots into an improv camp that has about 120 kids. Next year, we're probably doubling in size.
In the beginning with the Canadian Improv Games, the main force behind it was Willie Wyllie and his improv team at the time, Stage Fright.
First of all, I'd like to introduce the Stage Fright team from Ottawa, coached by Howard Jerome.
There were a number of young people who played, but who were also managers. And to be on a team and be as rowdy and as ridiculous as they wanted to do, but who also dealt with the schools one after another, implanting the Improv Olympic, which now is called Canadian Improv Games, into Canada, school after school.
Because there was no money to produce these games in the early days, Willie stepped forward from his own pocket before, during, and after he got married, and supported the games from his own pocket, tens of thousands of dollars over decades of time, out of his pocket, because he knows the magic of these games and sees the benefit to young people's lives.
But he managed to interest other organizations, such as the Great Canadian Theatre Company, which allowed us to use their resources to stage our matches.
We started in Ottawa, in Kingston, in Toronto. Andis and the NAC took it to Vancouver. Howard started it in Newfoundland. And then from there on, we didn't create the growth. It happened all by itself.
Willie had helped early on with funding and things like that, but honestly, the National Arts Center's sponsorship of the Canadian Improv Games is why we're here today and is why we are as successful as we are today. Without their funding, without their theater, without their support, there would be, honestly, no Canadian Improv Games in 2010.
The games that David created were very complex from a rule point of view. And so Howard and I sat down, we said, we've got to distill this into less games, and they're a lot easier.
The Canadians seem to have gotten this down. They've kind of both enlarged and refined the events so that they can be scored and so that the players will accept the scores that they get.
Where I see the Canadian Improv Games, starting with Howard and Willie, they distilled down from 11 games to 5 clear pillars of theater: story, style, character, theme, and life. The Canadian Improv Games does have a specific style. That's the perception from people from the improv world. But really what it is it's not that we're trying to make restrictions on their artistic choices. Just like English, mathematics, geography, there's a curriculum, you know, in every other class in high school, just like there are in Canadian Improv Games. We want to see specific outcomes. And that's why teachers love the program, and that's why students understand the program, and that's why when we have the presentations, we're able to evaluate the program.
This is the payoff for me. There's no money in this thing. The payoff is the kids you meet year after year after year who say more or less these words: you may not remember me, but, and then they fill in the blanks. I was strung out, I would have been pregnant, I was going to kill myself, that before I found my improv family.
And when you become like a family and there's trust, you open up things about yourself. That's extraordinary.
Basically, a whole bunch of parallel life skills are found in improvisation that allow kids that don't normally have opportunity to get opportunity and take action with that.
Sandra Oh is a classic example. Here was a young girl from a Chinese immigrant family who had to sooner or later declare her independence from their desires for her. And we saw it on stage. We were privileged to see Sandra Oh saying, I don't want to go. I don't want to walk the path that my parents want me to walk. And it was electric. And look what she's done with her life.
Kari Leslie, who's now a volunteer for us, is quoted as saying it was the best thing to ever happen to high school. Definitely for her.
That's the payoff for me, is seeing that we've changed the lives of tens of thousands of young people now.
I got a letter this year from a young woman who told me what a pleasure it was to be in the Canadian Improv Games and how it had helped her to develop friendships that she never would have had otherwise, and how she was going to go on into a college life where she would hopefully continue to improvise. And that made me feel very good, because I think there are thousands of young Canadians who feel the same way.
The Improv Olympics, starting in New York, taking real strong root in Ottawa, expanding out to Toronto, where now Australia came and played last year. Yeah, that was great.
He was experimenting with a variety of other projects, a lot of them involving video.
Right from the beginning of our work at the Space for Innovative Development, we had video cameras in our hands.
This eventually led into developing the movie experience.
All we have to do is come up with some really good scenarios, some great locations, some good characters, and we can make our own video movies.
What came into my mind was that movies could be improvised by small groups of people for a fraction of what it costs Hollywood to make a movie.
We can make our own stories, put them out on video, and show them on television. We thought it was very revolutionary at the time.
I started to look for a format that would be crisp.
My first experience with that format was in a party situation, where at the beginning of the party, we would talk about this story that we would want to do. And then we would do a warm-up, very much like an improv workshop, to loosen up the people and get them ready to play. We would have a board, which would have a list of, during the course of the evening, a scene might be shot in the living room, in the kitchen, outdoors, on the roof. It would be shot in chronological order, so at the end of the party, the participants can sit down and watch the movie they had just created.
Why I called this movie experience is because I felt that the process of making the movie was possibly even more important than the product.
Invariably, the end product is not as wonderful as the process has been. For all kinds of reasons, but the process is where it's at.
What was wonderful about the movie experience was that it always took place within a party environment.
It's a party game, you know? That's the way it is. Relax, enjoy each other's company, and do something creatively.
Strangers could meet for the first time and suddenly find themselves in a scene that could be very intimate and very revealing.
There's no good way to say this, so I'm just going to say it, but Ace has been diagnosed with leukemia. And he has, the doctors gave him about 6 months. And we wanted to make sure that he got to be with his family, and this day is about him. Where's Ace?
See, he's right over
there. Hey, has anybody seen Ace? Ace!
It's okay.
Ace! There you are. What are you doing?
I can't take it anymore.
It's all right. It's all right.
I'm gonna die.
You're gonna be okay. You're gonna have the treatments, and you're gonna be all better. Come on. No, don't listen to her. We know, we've checked all the possibilities. This is the best thing for you, okay? You're gonna make it, okay? It's gonna be all right. Love you too.
Sometimes some of these movies would be broadcast on a local cable access station. Other times we would just dupe copies so that people could have this as a memento.
I worked on this for more than 10 years.
His book, which is that movie in your head, we've all had that thing, that movie in your head. Well, he says, let's get it out of your head, put it on camera. The technology is now here. It wasn't always here.
But I didn't realize that what was going to happen was YouTube was going to come into existence, and that would propel people into making their own movies because YouTube was there. In other words, the technology came into a position where it would attract people.
Now that we have cyberspace and digital media, that we can make our own video movies, and they can be a joy. They don't have to be full-length movies. You can make shorts. But again, follow the format. David laid it out. He did all the experiments. He did all the failures. He said, here's how I failed 600 times with lights and sound and locations and people. Here's how I failed to organize this, that, or the other. You don't have to fail to do that now. He did all the failing for us.
Yeah. Movie experience led to the creation of Act Now, which is a program created by Nancy Fletcher, David's partner.
Nancy Fletcher is an angel. You'd have to be to deal with David.
David goaded me into doing a movie experience for him, and it was my birthday in 1998. We proceeded to have a brainstorm that evening here in my house. The next day, 35 people came for my birthday and to do this crazy thing. It was thrilling for me. And a light bulb went off, and I said, this is something I want to do full time. I had always been interested in girls' self-esteem. And a beat later, I said, oh my God, I could do this with girls. We wouldn't even have to talk about self-esteem. It would just be an empowerment exercise. And it was really from scratch that I started Act Now.
Act Now is a nonprofit that builds confidence and character in young girls through a unique method that uses improvisation and movie-making techniques. One of our programs is a five-day intensive called Movie Experience Play Shop, in which girls 11 to 14 improvise their own movie. They make up the story, they create the characters, they handle the props and costumes, and all the behind the scenes, and improvise each scene on camera. So at the end of 5 days, the movie is completely done and they sit down and watch it.
She stepped forward at the perfect time and brings her love and her support, and has learned from David how to take these games and use them to heal the girls she's working with.
Over the course of 10 years now, Nancy has produced 31 movies.
Well, we're in the offices here of Nancy Fletcher's Act Now, and Nancy has put together a facility that makes it possible for movie experience to travel around the United States and other parts of the world.
In 2007, we received the results of a study that Mount Holyoke psychologists have done that showed that the movie experience is 100% effective in raising self-esteem in girls at risk and 83% effective in raising self-esteem in girls from the general population. And they did a look back of 5 years of the girls that we've worked with. And this is a very powerful tool that never would have connected with these girls had it not been for David.
I got feedback through Nancy about how my format is now affecting young women here in Massachusetts and other parts of the world, and it makes me feel very good that this is going on a continuing basis into the future.
I learned how to do better at improv,
expand my acting.
I was feeling better, like my confidence was boosting.
I have a pen. I hope to take the skills I learned here and really apply it.
I think I might get together with a couple of the girls that went here, and we might try to make a movie of our own.
The next logical thing is you take Act Now and bring it out into the world.
One of the things that
we're on the cusp of a real breakthrough is that we're codifying all that I've learned from David and all that I've learned working with the girls, and we're putting it into curriculum so that other people can use it. It's really so versatile. There's no group of people that you could do it with that wouldn't be benefited by it.
Act Now brings to Moo Experience the power to maintain it and thrust it into the future. They've been doing this for 10 years. I expect that after Nancy leaves, other people will pick it up and run with it, not only in the Valley in the United States, but all over the world. So this makes me feel very good that my little ideas are being broadcast now on a larger spectrum. And I'm on the training committee that's going to make it possible for this curriculum to be devised and produced and distributed.
I have to credit David for inspiring me. First of all, he opened the doors to this idea, this format. Just as Alan Arkin says, he's the Johnny Appleseed of improv. And he planted a seed with me.
David continues to blow my mind with his constant research into human creativity, one of the latest forms being life play, in which people meet each other on the phone, sometimes for the first time, and improvise with each other on the phones, given various formats that he's still developing in his mid-80s.
What inspired life play is the need to go into a life that may be very superficial and find details in that life which could be probed and brought into focus and made important enough to say to yourself, well, this is the way I believe, this is the way I don't believe, this is what happened last week, this is why, this is how I felt about it, this is what I want to happen in my life. This is how I relate to other people, if only on the phone.
The games are designed to bring these two players closer, these two disembodied voices closer, through sharing emotional experiences, revealing things about your dreams and your hopes and your desires. It's very intimate, but it can also reveal surprises about yourself that you didn't realize before.
The life play, I enjoyed it myself just last week. I got to do things I'd never done before.
This format is still very much in its early developmental stages. In fact, yesterday we had a life play session where we're still trying to iron out the kinks with different games.
That's what's happening on the table behind me. Got some people who have been playing for 9 months, other people who are playing for the first time today, and they're tussling with this format, trying to make it work. Some of it is working very well, and other new games are not working at all. And so the people who invented them are struggling to make them come out right.
So like one player gives a strong emotion to the other, who expresses it in speech or in song, with or without words, then switch roles. Pitch a strong emotion, not an attitude to your partner. What was the emotion?
Joy.
Joy. Can I?
Can I break out of this forest domain? Can I break through the brambles and the pine? And can I find a place where I really feel at home, like on a beach? Can I break through the situation in which I'm alone all day long and join my friends at the cafe in Amherst? Can I get out of this situation where I have projects over my head all day long from the time I wake up in the morning until the time I go to sleep? And can I get out of the mood of saying to myself all the time, when can I go to bed? Period.
It was very looking forward to joy. That was nice.
Every so often I call him up and I tell him, it's the angel of death. Are you ready yet? This is not ready yet, so we can play something else.
I don't know whether it's going to be a part of the future or not. And I don't know whether other people are doing this. It could be another group of people are doing exactly the same thing in Europe or in China. We're not looking to stamp this, you know, with copyright and warnings that nobody can use it. It hasn't come to that yet. It's still nebulous. It's still in formation. It's still malleable. And I'll probably go on doing this for the rest of my life. Life play is a mystery. And we're trying to find out what the mystery is and how to shape it so that it can serve millions of people in the world. I might as well confess, I would like to see it played by millions of people in all countries.
So when you think about David's legacy from way back when, from the Compass Players to Second City, right on to Community Makers and Improv Games and movie making, and now into life play, the work continues to ripple out. That the what did I say about David? That stone that he dropped into the pond of improvisation seems to ripple out into eternity. There's no stopping it. There's a tsunami of improv out there.
I really hope, fervently hope, that David receives the recognition and respect that he deserves, and I think that he hasn't really gotten that. Because he's not, there's no flash to him, you know. He's not a self-aggrandizer. He says some kind of goofy things. And people, maybe don't understand what he actually did.